Well, hi, this is Burns Hargis with another edition of Inside OSU, and we have a very special guest today, Robert Ballard, who is one of the great oceanographers of our time, maybe in history. You may know him from discovering the Titanic, but there have been a number of other discoveries that we're going to talk about. We're very excited to have him here, the former Navy officer, and now one associated with the University of Rhode Island. Is here for Research Week. So welcome, Bob.
Nice We're to be here. To Pleasure you. To see you again. It's been how many years?
Been about, 25 years,
25
I think.
25 years.
You had just found that, what year did you?
85.
Okay, it would have been right about
right
then.
Right about then.
Yeah, when we had you down, probably in 80, late 80s.
You were just
80s.
A child back then.
Both of us were.
Yeah.
Your career is, it's not like that was the end of your accomplishments.
It was my 70th expedition when I did that one.
Is that right?
I've been in the game a little while before that.
Well, there have been some other pretty incredible things, but all of them have a common denominator, which is these deep diving submersibles that you helped develop, I understand.
Yep, I spent 25 years in that freezing elevator, but then I got smart and now I got these amazing robots.
As I say, you have those common denominators, and of course the Titanic is probably one of the most celebrated of them all, and we want to hear a little bit about that. But also you found the battleship Bismarck.
Yep, and President Kennedy's BT-109.
Yeah.
And the Yorktown, a few other things. But actually—
Now, did you just stumble onto those things?
No, that was my mission. I was after that. But I did those for National Geographic, but my favorite discoveries are the ones when we tripped over more important things, like new life forms and hydrothermal vents and mineral deposits and really honest discoveries, because those are the ones I'm proudest of. Actually.
Well, you had one that certainly would get some note, and that is finding some evidence of the big flood.
We were going into the Black Sea because there's no oxygen below 200 meters. So it preserves ancient history. We just found a ship down there, preserved from 500 BC that had human remains on it.
Wow.
Because of the anoxia. So we went in there actually to look for ancient shipwrecks. But just as I was going, I read this book by two colleagues of mine at Columbia University called Noah's Flood, where they predicted that the biblical flood actually occurred in the Black Sea, because that's where the Bible puts it, Mount Ararat, Turkey. Mm-hmm. So we thought we'd take a side trip and see if we could find that ancient shoreline. We did. We went down, found where it was before the flood occurred.
Talk about a little bit of your journey that made you want to find the Titanic and how you went about it.
Well, it all began reading 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea when I was a kid. And I wanted to be
Jules Verne.
I wanted to be Captain Nemo. Yeah. And I told my parents I wanted to be Captain Nemo, and they didn't laugh, fortunately. Because you should never laugh at a kid's dream, even if it's silly. They worked with me on it, and they said, well, tell me a little bit more about Captain Nemo. I said, well, he had a submarine, the Nautilus. So he took me down to the sub base. It was right down the street, and I went aboard a diesel sub, went in the Navy, became a naval officer for 30 years. Then they said, yeah, but you know, what? Nautilus was more.
So you were in the Navy for 30 years?
Yeah, I started out in the Army during Vietnam. I was an Army intelligence officer, and then they moved me into the Navy, and I was in naval intelligence. In fact, a really interesting fact that only recently can I tell you without shooting you is the Titanic was a cover for a series of military operations I was doing.
Really?
We had lost two submarines during the Cold War, Thresher and the Scorpion. And they wanted me we'd lost nuclear weapons on the Scorpion. And they wanted me to find them. And they didn't want the Russians to know where we were, so I had to have a cover story.
So it was looking for the Titanic,
were they in the general area? They were in the general nearby. So I had to do their mission first, and I had.
So you find them?
I did the whole job, but then I ate up most of the time, and I only had 12 days left finding the Titanic. So I had to get creative and lucky.
I'm sure I've heard you say that the ocean floor is probably less explored than the moon.
Oh, we got better maps of Mars. Than half of our own country. 50% of the United States is underwater. Full of resources.
I didn't know that.
Oil and trillions of dollars worth of oil and gas. Unbelievable mineral resources. We're finding copper, lead, silver, zinc, and gold in commercial concentrations. We're finding strategic minerals coating on the sides of seamounts in American waters. And we haven't even mapped our own country.
Yeah.
That's nuts.
So is that your next quest?
Yep, I'm moving my ship and we're gonna start exploring America. And we're doing a big article in National Geographic November issue. It's the 125th anniversary of the Society. And we're gonna do an article in the November issue called Exploring the Hidden America. We're gonna pull it out and show you the ball game.
Tell me about the Jason Project.
Well, it's funny because when I found the Titanic, it was like my 70th expedition, so I wasn't a new kid on the block. But we helped prove plate tectonics, we found the origin of life on the planet, but I never got a letter from a kid for any of the serious things we were doing. You know, we did a lot of serious stuff, but no one was paying much attention to it. And I find this ship on the bottom of the ocean. I got 16,000 letters the next week from kids saying, I want to do what you do. What do I have to do? And so I saw in their curiosity a chance to try to get them excited about science and technology. There's a disconnect with our academic establishment and our culture. Our culture is American culture. It's not European. And we have a star-based system. We have star athletes and movie stars. And the academic community is not an I, it's a we. So there's a disconnect. And so what we decided was don't sell kids on science, sell them on scientists, and make sure they're not a nerd. You know, you needed role models. You needed people that kids wanted to emulate. On my ship, the Nautilus, is the core of exploration. I stole it from Lewis and Clark, core discovery. I call them the core of exploration. And when you go on our website, you're gonna see every face in this country in the game. And a kid sees their face 20 years out, they say, if that person can do it, I can do it. So it's role modeling.
So maybe at the end, that'll be a more important contribution.
Oh, I think my legacy in the long run will be the kids.
Yeah.
My grandmother said, you know, and she attributed her saying to Johnny Appleseed. She said, great is the person who plants a tree knowing they will never sit in its shade. Right. And that's these kids. You know, I'm 71, I'll never see the fruit. But I'm going to plant those trees.
That's fantastic. Bob, pleasure. Thank you very much. Bob Ballard proves that you can be born in Oklahoma and end up discovering half of the United States underwater.
Yeah, absolutely. I need you. Come on aboard.
That's right. That's right. The Jason Project. Look it up. Thank you for being here. This is a great kickoff to Research Week. We'll see you next time on Inside OSU.